Good to see you out today. Grab your psalm books and let's stand. Turn to page 250. Page 250, He Keeps Me Singing, lifted up on that verse.
See you. Thanks for being out and being in the service this morning. If you're a guest, we're so glad that you're here. If this is your first time, maybe your first time in a while, hope the service will be a blessing and a help to you. And I do hope that you'll stop by in the foyer. We have a gift for you. It's just our way of saying thank you to you, and we're glad that you're here. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask for His help as we begin. Father, we're thankful that we can come, and Lord, we sure are grateful for the Word of God. We want to thank You for the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and what it means to us, the freedom that it gives us, the forgiveness of sin, and the opportunity to receive You as Savior and have a home in heaven. And I pray that that message would be clear this morning as we look into the Word of God. I pray that You'd stir us all, that we would be faithful to You, and we would live for You. Lord, may our time not be in vain. I pray the Word of God would find a lodging place in our hearts, and then help us, Lord, to respond as You see fit. Thank You for friends and guests that are here. May You have Your way in our hearts today. Bless our singing. In Jesus' name, amen. Stay standing. Turn to page 264 in your hymn book, if you would.
Page 264, He is able to deliver thee. seated. Psalmbooks and stand with us. Turn to page 341. Page 341, Victory in Jesus. Lift it up on that first.
Precious blood of holy, and I.
a moment, greet those around you. Back on that chorus when she comes around.
Savior. I read this week where late in one of the evenings there were some conservatives who were singing victory when the Republicans finally got a speaker. Well, I'm just going to tell you, it won't take 15 times for the Lord. Amen? Glad about that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Klein, would you lead us?
you can remain seated. Turn page 298. Page 298, Now I Belong to Jesus.
Coming down from the Father above.
Thank you, Ms. Kay. Take your Bible, turn to the book of Acts, chapter 5, if you would. The book of Acts, chapter 5. I would encourage you, if you don't have a Bible, perhaps you can find one there in the pew in front of you. I hope that you'll be able to follow along. There are several verses in particular that you're going to need to see as we go through these verses. Acts chapter 5. I don't know that anyone could ever rightly call the book of Acts a dull book. I mean, it seems like from chapter to chapter, something's happening every minute. And as we get into these particular verses this morning, you would know that in the first couple chapters, you're looking at early Christians who were on fire for God. I mean, these are people who tackled the world, the flesh, and the devil head on. They were courageous in what they believed about God. And they were called upon to take a stand for the Lord. And the result of that was that the local officials and the religious leaders didn't like that. If you've studied the book of Acts, you're familiar with that, and you know that that's part of the context. And oftentimes there are many places throughout Acts where as they preached the Lord Jesus Christ, they would get in trouble with the local leadership. And so they had to decide, what do we really believe about the Lord? What do we really believe about God's word or the law or our faith? And there would be no place for them to be a fence straddler. There would be no place for them to be a compromiser or to have any kind of a half-hearted faith. And here's what I found, as was true in that day, it's still true in our day. Unfortunately, there are many who try to remain neutral about faith. Because somehow we have believed that that is easier. And that's the case of this man in particular, maybe not so well known. He's at the end of chapter 5. It's a man by the name of Gamaliel. And we maybe don't spend a whole lot of time speaking or reading about him, but this morning I'd like to see his response here to these folks in Acts chapter 5. If you're able to stand, can I invite you to do that as we read the Word of God just out of respect for the Scripture? Let's begin in verse 34. Acts chapter 5, find verse 34 if you would. Then stood there up one in the council, a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a doctor of the law, had in reputation among all the people, and commanded to put the apostles forth a little space, and said unto them, Ye men of Israel, take heed to yourselves what ye intend to do as touching these men. For before these days rose up Theudas, boasting himself to be somebody, to whom a number of men, about 400, joined themselves, who were slain, and all, as many as obeyed him, were scattered and brought to naught. After this man rose up Judas of Galilee in the days of the taxing, and drew away much people after him, he also perished, and all, even as many as obeyed him, were dispersed. And now I say unto you, refrain from these men, and let them alone. For if this counsel or this work be of men, it will come to naught. But if it be of God, ye cannot overthrow it, lest haply ye be found even to fight against God. Now, I've entitled the message this morning, A Religious Pacifier. And I hope that you'll see the context of that as we get into the Scripture. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be in your house. We're grateful that we've been able to join together in song and to enjoy worshiping you. But Lord, we've come to hear from you. Now we've offered our praise and our thanksgiving, and Father, we ask that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, I realize that you must do the work. You must take the Scripture, and the Holy Spirit must be present. And so I'm asking, Lord, that those would be true in this very hour. For these few moments, I pray that you would bind Satan and the hindrances that he would like to bring to the gospel and the Word of God. And may you give us an alertness this morning to hear from you. We'll thank you and praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. How many of you remember as a child or as an infant, maybe you don't remember, but you remember being told that you used a pacifier. You don't have to be embarrassed by that. Only six people in here used a pacifier. A pacifier is a device, an instrument, a tool, a piece of plastic. It's something that's given to an infant, usually to substitute or to kind of satisfy the desire of a baby when it thinks it needs to eat, but it really doesn't need to eat. And usually, we use a pacifier to calm a fussy baby. How many as parents used a pacifier? All right, there's a lot more hands there, I suppose. It's amazing. I was thinking about how the names and the products have changed over the years. We grew up with it being called a pacifier, and it was a little rubber piece of instrument that you would shove in the mouth of the baby. But all of a sudden, I realized as I was a parent and as time progressed that people were looking for their Binky or their Wookie. I'm looking around, I'm like, well, I don't know what a Wookiee is, but I'll help you look for the Wookiee. They're looking for a teething ring. I remember using a teething ring, chewing on. My mom would put it in the freezer, and then she would give it to us to chew on. I'm not sure if that was cruel or if that's what you were supposed to do. I'm not sure. Sometimes it's a calming necklace. That's the new one. I guess that came with this generation behind us. Just throw the calming necklace or bracelet on your child, and they won't cry or they'll chew on the necklace. Now, maybe you've used those. I'm not here to say that's right or wrong. You're looking at me kind of cross-eyed. It's okay. Trust me. But those are devices or instruments that we use, and oftentimes they're used to try to satisfy or to pacify. They really didn't become modernized, at least what I could find, in the United States until the early 1900s. But there's history that used them long before the United States. In Europe, in the early 1800s, they would take a dish rag and they would put sugar in it, and then they would wrap it up and they would give it to the child to suck on that little ball of sugar. Now, I wish my mom would have done that. In Germany, they would fill up a rag with poppy seeds, and they would dip it in brandy and give it to the infant. It's no wonder they were pacified. I mean, good night, you think about that, but these are things that we might use in a pacifier. Well, a mother might look through her diaper bag or her backpack and find that, and she would put it in the mouth of that child, and hopefully they would be satisfied or calmed a little bit longer. But what happens if a child drops that pacifier on the floor? We got the men saying put it back, and we've got the women picking it up and licking it off. How many of you mothers know? Don't raise your hand. Oh, it's fine. We're just in Walmart. Surely the floors in Walmart are clean. By the way, we survived that, didn't we? And we didn't get COVID. And I suppose there's nothing wrong with that. It's just a reminder of where we've come and who we are. But every piece of that is intended to satisfy or soothe maybe a crying child or an upset child and hopefully get them to calm down a little bit. It appears to me that this one by the name of Gamaliel is trying to accomplish that with these people in Acts chapter 5. Here's where we're at. Thus far, in the book of Acts, you're reading about the church triumphant. We sang earlier about victory in Jesus, and these people knew about it. They were marching forward in victory. Chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4. I mean, the church was ferocious, and they were growing, and God was blessing. And it would have been exciting to be a part of that first church in the opening verses. I believe somewhere in there, Satan had realized and decided he couldn't conquer the church, he couldn't overcome the church, so maybe Satan might try another tactic and just try to infiltrate the church or corrupt the church. So when you get to Acts chapter 5, the first word of chapter 5, verse 1, is the word but. On the heels of all of that victory, now Satan will try a tactic to infiltrate the work of God, and he starts on the inside. verse number one, we're introduced to these people, this husband and wife by the name of Ananias and Sapphira. And they, if you know the story, they lied to the apostles. They lied to the Holy Ghost. And by the way, can I just tell you, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes some of the worst devastation that comes to the church starts on the inside. And in Acts chapter 5, the first few verses, God put it to rest very quickly. The trouble was broken up. God dealt with it. And they were both smitten and their lives were taken. Well, Satan wasn't victorious there. So you get to about verse number 18. And now Satan tries to do a work to perhaps corrupt the church from the outside. So here come these leaders that don't like what Peter and the other apostles are preaching, and they throw them into prison. And they're brought later, about long verse number 28 or 29, they're brought before the council, and they are questioned about it. It's interesting, I love this passage of Scripture, and I love the storyline that's there. We read this in our own family devotions last night, and I was telling my boys that wouldn't have been great to be a part of that, and you're out in the streets or in the temple preaching, and all of a sudden these people come and they arrest you, they throw you into prison. Somewhere along the night, an angel comes, takes you out of prison, puts you back in the temple and says, keep on preaching. Boy, that would have been cool. And they show up the next day. They go in and they say, well, that doesn't make sense. The prison cell's locked. But they're not in here. The door has not been messed with. The lock has not been cut. They're not in here. Along comes another messenger and said, I found them. They're back in the temple preaching. And they're brought before the council, and they're questioned about that. And if you were to take the time and you were to read the Scripture, Peter stands, and with boldness and courage, he gives to them a message from God, and he tells them that we're to obey God, not to obey man. By the way, you're the ones who slew Jesus, and you hanged him upon a tree, and you took his life, and the Holy Ghost brought us here. Ain't no wonder verse 33 says they were cut to the heart. I mean, when you talk about a sermon like that, verse about 29 or so to about verse number 32, the sermon that Peter preached, what you'd find is the Trinity's in it. You'd find that Calvary's in it. You'd find the resurrection in it. You'd find forgiveness in it. You would find all those things, all the while the Holy Spirit of God has charged those that are listening. They're murderers. It is on that foundation that we begin reading verse 34. Satan couldn't do a work from the inside of the church, at least in chapter 5. He couldn't do a work from outside the church with the council members, or at least in chapter 5. And so now Satan tries a third tactic found in chapter 5, and he tries to bring trouble in disguise. Gamaliel's kind of one of those men who looks good on the outside, and there's trouble on the fence. The Bible tells us he is one of the council. He's a Pharisee. He's a doctor of the law. He's got a reputation among the people. His name is Gamaliel. He's a famous teacher, and he stands up to quell the murmurings of those that are about to go after Peter and the apostles. And I can almost hear him in verse number 35 as he says to them, let's just be patient. Now, ye men of Jerusalem, just wait for a moment and just set back for a minute and let's just be careful. And I got to tell you that on the surface, this speech sounds pretty good. Sounds sane, sounds sober. In fact, it may even be level-headed in some ways and seems like it's reasonable, the advice that he gives. But ladies and gentlemen, the fact of the matter is Gamaliel was an appeaser and a compromiser. When you understand the passage and you understand who he is, we might even be able to go so far as to say he's one of the first protagonists of tolerance found on the pages of history. See, preacher, how can you say that? I'll tell you how I can say that. There's no excuse for Gamaliel. When you have a rap sheet like verse number 34, when you have the qualifications of verse number 34, Gamaliel knew there was a teacher in Israel. Gamaliel knew to look for the Messiah. Gamaliel knew the scriptures and the law. In fact, he knew who Jesus was because he had fulfilled the very law that Gamaliel had given his life to study, and he had done it right in the vicinity of where Gamaliel lived and where he taught. He knew all of these things as he studied the law. Now's not a time for him to question God. Now's not a time for him to step back from making a decision. He should have taken a stand with Peter and with the apostles. He should have risen up in that verse and said, "Fellas, they're right. That was the Son of God." But he didn't. Fact of the matter is, to his disgrace, he didn't defend the name of the Lord at all. Now you may say, "Preacher, well, you have to understand, he has a reputation. That would have been difficult for him." That's true. And so because it would have been difficult, listen, he chose neither to stand for or stand against. Because it was going to be hard or maybe uncomfortable, or because it would have been a little bit challenging, he stood maybe not for and not, "I'll just stay in the middle." Here's a study for you sometime. I haven't mined it all out in the scripture, but I find a similar theme throughout the book of Acts. Some of the worst enemies of the early apostles were not the opposers, they were the appeasers. They weren't the ones who necessarily stood against in every case, but the ones that just tried to make it all be kind and good and gentle and it all go away. Can I give you three clear mistakes that he made and the outcome of them? If you got a place to maybe jot a couple things down, I want to just walk through these verses that we read a moment ago. First of all, I want you to notice the test of time. The first thing that Gamaliel does is he gives the test of time, beginning in verse number 35, and then also again he repeats it at the very first phrase or so of verse number 38. Gamaliel was trying to calm the people, which, by the way, these people in verse number 33 wanted to kill them. The Bible says in verse number 33 that they were cut to the heart and they sought for a way that they would take their lives and they would kill them. So Gamaliel stands up, and his message is very subtle. Time will tell. Now let's just see whether this supposed real faith of Peter and them, let's just see if it has any measurable success. Now listen to me and listen carefully. Sometimes we read those verses that Gamaliel spoke, and there are some tones of truth. We'll see those in a moment. But understand what he is presenting to them is, "Ladies and gentlemen, ye men of Israel, now, let's just see if there's any measurable fact or if there's any reality to the faith that these people have." Can I remind you, ladies and gentlemen, that the world's yardstick doesn't apply to the Lord Jesus Christ. God doesn't measure success by what the world measures success by. According to the popular polls in Jesus' day, let's just think through what we know. By the time you get to Acts chapter 5, Jesus would have been a failure. If we were to look at where we are in Acts chapter 5, Jesus died a disgrace. He died as a criminal. He was hung upon a tree. In fact, the Bible tells us that when he died, his followers scattered, and there was no unity there. They were gone to the edges, and they were hiding in places, and the world certainly wasn't converted. Would look to me like, by the pages of history, that certainly Jesus was a failure. History has come and gone, and centuries have come and gone, and still to this day, many would say that Caesar was the ruler of that day on the throne, but not Jesus. So as Gamaliel stands, it looks like the world and the flesh and the devil, it looks like they've had their way and the world is lost. And who are these few men who are left trying to raise a ruckus? But I want to remind you today, success in the Bible and success in God's eyes is not the same as the world's eyes. The rule of thumb is not, yes, time will tell, as Gamaliel presents it, although I would say to you today that certainly time will tell, because all of eternity will bear out that He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Certainly that will be the case, but Gamaliel knew the law. Gamaliel knew the Scriptures. He knew of whom he spoke of, and a person who waits to take his stand or takes his opinion on the Lord Jesus Christ until he sees whether the church fares or whether the Bible comes to be fruition or whether or not the gospel plays out, that person takes their stand alongside a man like Gamaliel. Visible and successes are not the proof of Jesus or His followers. There was not ever a rap sheet that said, well, if these things be true, then indeed He must be the Messiah. There is. It's found in the Old Testament. And Gamaliel checked every one of those boxes. But yet, they were measuring it according to these others. And Gamaliel was wrong because he knew who Jesus was. What more time do you need to tell? But there was the test of time. And cowardly, he stayed on the fence. Number two is the measure of man. Number one, the test of time. Number two is the measure of man. Now, it's interesting to me that in verse number 36 and verse number 37, he cites the cases of two men, a man by the name of Theudas and Judas. According to what we're reading here, and there's not a whole lot in history about them, but these were religious men who led religious movements, but it all came to naught. So you're talking about a man who stands up and he's got his followers, and they're down in a commune in Texas somewhere, and he proclaims that he himself is the Messiah, and it comes to naught. That's what we're reading about if we were to make connection in our common day vernacular. And the problem was, although the apostles, Peter and others, were the ones standing there, they're not the ones on trial. It's Jesus. After all, it was Jesus who died. After all, it was Jesus who started this movement, if you will, or this faith that was passed down. It was Jesus. And by the way, can I just remind you, you can't compare Jesus to any man. Jesus Christ never makes the comparison of Himself. He never admits to any comparison. Sometimes there's a tendency, even in popular religion today, that we compare Christianity with man-made religious enterprises, and we compare it to what this ministry does or what that ministry does. But ladies and gentlemen, the standard is not this ministry. It's not that ministry. It's not the church down the road. The standard is the Lord Jesus Christ. By the way, the Apostle Paul never in any of his writings or in any of his preaching, he never tried to convince people that Jesus Christ was one of the solutions. He never tried to convince people that the gospel was the best solution. Paul said, it's the only solution. And Gamaliel makes the wrong comparison. All other comparisons are out of line. Now, Theudas and Judas, you can compare them to other men and other movements as much as you want to. You can compare them to other men in history as much as you would like, but they cannot be compared to the Lord Jesus Christ. God has spoken, and Jesus has come, and He's lived, and He's died, and He's rose again. That's final. And Gamaliel knew that. If there were ever times when Gamaliel would try to liken Jesus Christ to anyone or anything else, he is likening the incomparable one to fleshly mankind. He is likening the Lord Jesus Christ and bringing Him down to the level of mankind. But can I just remind you, you can't measure the Messiah by men. There's the test of time and the measure of men. And then number three, the answer to appease. The test of time, the measure of men. Number three is the answer to appease. Now watch verse 38. And this is oftentimes where we would read verse 33 and then we would jump ahead to verse 38 or 39. If it be of men, then it will come to naught. But if it be of God, then you can't overthrow it anyways. Now let me ask you a question. Is part or all of that true? Absolutely. But the part that's false, that's the wrong conclusion, what do you mean by if? What purpose is if? Ladies and gentlemen, can I remind you, you cannot play hands off with the cause of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "He that is not with me is against me." It was Jesus that made that statement. You can't suspend judgment as if somehow you're the judge. You are either dead or alive. You are either saved or you're lost. You're either a Christian or you're not a Christian. This idea that I'll just wait a little while and I'll just see how it all plays out. I'll just see if it shakes up and then I'll make up my mind when I see all the facts. And when the facts come in, then I'll decide whether or not I want to accept the Lord or whether I want to believe on Him. I don't know about you, but I'm a little bothered by this generation or this era that's kind of passing this around, that you just wait until you see if the Bible stands up to be true or not. You just wait until you measure up whether or not you think that it's all accurate, and then you can make your decision about eternity. My friend, you wait all you want to, but the Bible will still be true, and God's Word will still be God's Word, and God will still be on the throne, and Jesus Christ is still the Savior. And to not make a decision about the Word of God is to make a decision about the Word of God. This idea that Gamaliel gave this answer was just to appease them, like he's putting Jesus on trial. Like we're going to wait and see whether Jesus measures up. Like he has the right to say, well, let's just wait and find out if he really was the Messiah or not. You know what Gamaliel knew about the law? The law said that we are all guilty and we are all condemned because we are all sinners. He knew that. You know what else he knew about the law? That the wrath of God abides on us. I'm glad that I can say today that mercy has been offered to you and to me, but mercy is not indefinite. The Bible says, "He that believeth on Him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already." Why? Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. That means that there are no fence sitters. You either are or you aren't. You can't just leave Jesus Christ alone and decide you'll deal with it the next day, or you'll decide when it's convenient for you. My friend, eternity is there, and it doesn't change what you believe. You don't have the right or the privilege to put God on trial, or the Word of God on trial, or Jesus Christ on trial, any more than Gamaliel did. He was mistaken. Now, it sounds like a sound response, but the reason he said that was not to prove a truth. It was to pacify the crowd. He was right when he said, if the gospel were of men, that it would come to naught. But there is no if. He was right when he said, if it were of God, then you can't stop it. But there is no if. Because those are stated facts, and they are true. Because if we were to accept that, now maybe you're thinking, well, preacher, I think he meant the right thing. All right, let's just think about that. If you accept Gamaliel's answer, then you have to say, well, if I die in my sins. No, if you die in your sins, you are condemned. Everybody okay with that? If the Bible says, if we die in our sins, then it will all come of naught, and we shall all likewise perish. The gospel is not on trial. Jesus is not on trial. It's you and I who are sinners, and we are the ones that are on trial. And it's not until you believe on the only begotten Son of God that you can be saved. Jesus Christ has paid the price. Jesus has proved himself. Jesus has done all that Jesus needs to do. You're not the judge. I'm not the judge. The Word of God stands true. And I'm glad that God offers a solution to the lost, aren't you? If we receive it, we are saved. If we leave it, we are lost. And unless you take salvation, you have indeed left it. Do not convince yourself today that you're sitting in this service and you'll just decide to wait a little bit and maybe you'll think, well, I'm going to read a few more verses and I'll figure it out down the road, or I'll just take another chance for it. My friend, you can come back the next week and the next week and the next week, and it's still going to be true and it's still going to be right, and the message is still going to be the same, and Jesus is not going to change, and salvation's not going to change. It's the heart of man that needs to change. But that's just the beginning. That's just the beginning of Gamaliel's answer. That's just the launching pad for what he would pacify the crowd with. I was thinking about how that maybe it reminds us a little bit of Elijah going all the way back to Mount Carmel. Here's Elijah, and he's called down fire from heaven. If you remember the story, there's 7,000 prophets in Israel who haven't bowed the knee. That's what God said. But there's also 450 prophets of Baal. And you remember what happened when Elijah had called down the fire and he brought the congregation together? Elijah made a question to them. He said, "How long halt ye between two opinions?" Do you remember what the people's answer was? The Bible says, "And they answered him not a word." Excuse me, it was not check yes, check no, check maybe. It was not do you like me, yes or no or maybe. You don't get that. You remember getting those letters when you were like in the fourth grade? Maybe is no. If you check the box maybe, then no, you don't like me. Elijah wasn't giving them those kind of options. And the scripture says they answered him not a word. He said, if God be God, then follow him. But if Baal be God, then follow him. They would not commit. Here we are all these years later in Acts chapter 5, and the same thing's happening. You fast forward from Elijah, you fast forward from Acts chapter 5, you get yourself into the year 2023. Ladies and gentlemen, we are living in a day of appeasement. It starts in the home where we spare the rod and spoil the child. Excuse me, some kids don't need a pacifier. Thank you, I'm glad somebody helped me. They need a board. Now, I'm not preaching that message this morning, so that's fine. You do what you want with it. But it continues in the school where right and wrong are kind of up in the air, and it all becomes relative. It shows up in the government where they abuse power and they exploit truth, and then they refuse to stand when they are called upon to stand. It has continued to infect the church, and in no uncertain terms and uncertain words, just like Acts chapter 5, verse number 33, it cuts to the heart. And yet, we breathe tolerance. Shows up in the Laodicean church age of lukewarmness, where we're too hot to be cold and we're too cold to be hot. And the Bible says that gives God a stomachache. It is nauseous to the nostrils of the God of heaven. Do you realize that the gospel usually makes men mad, sad, or glad? In fact, just look at the book of Acts. All three of them are there. Peter is glad in the Lord. The council was mad. Look at verse 33. They wanted to kill him. But then there comes Gamaliel, and he's neither. He's just on the fence. He's just wants to make sure that he appeases everybody. He wants to make sure that everybody has their best day ever and everybody feels wonderful about it and that everything is just great and nothing will be harmful and there won't be. Ladies and gentlemen, if we take that approach, then people will die and go to hell. And we're at fault. And you're at fault. And I'm at fault. And the church is at fault. Such a spirit shows up in pulpits where Gamaliels flourish and men are too bashful and too cowardly to speak the truth. I wonder, where are the Nathan the prophets who will point a finger and say, "Thou art the man"? It doesn't matter to me if you get offended or if it hurts your little tiny feelings on the way out the door, but the truth of the Word of God is the truth. That's where Gamaliel should have stood. This is an issue of life and death. This is eternity and heaven and hell. It doesn't call for suspended judgment. It doesn't call for us to wait another day and just perhaps it'll get better or we'll figure it out along the way. And maybe perhaps the greatest ally of Satan in this world is the tolerance where everything is good and everything that's black and white is all of a sudden gray and it's all just a blurry mix of religious things and we feel better because there are Gamaliels who are saying, Now, ye men of Israel. Now, there's really, don't get, if perhaps in 2023, if we were to interpret in our vernacular Gamaliel's words in verse 35, it might look like, don't get too excited about Peter's Jesus. Why would you get too excited about this Jesus that Peter's talking about? Don't take sides. Let's just see how. I get weary of a young person who is 18 years old or 26 years old, and somehow they think they know everything about everything, and they probably even never read the Bible through. And somehow, you're the critic, and you're the judge, and you say to your mother, or you say to some Sunday school teacher, "Well, I'm just going to wait and see." Who do you think you are? That's where Gamaliel was. And he should have taken a stand for what he knew to be true. Do you know there are some things in life that are too important that you must contend for them? We're too tired to live for God. We're too timid to stand for God. We're too tame to witness for God. And we are comfortable and lazy and apathetic. And God give us some Christians who will get off the fence and, excuse me, get the pacifier out of your mouth and speak up for God. What do you mean you're afraid that your boss is going to get offended if you tell them about Jesus? What do you mean your spouse or your grown... Sometimes people say to me, "Well, preacher, you know, I just try not to bring that up with my kids." What's wrong with you? As if there is a neutral answer. Now, I understand that we ought to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves, but the truth of the matter is, this is where Gamaliel is when he should have stood for God and he should have taken a stand, and yet he knew who his followers were and he knew what he said that day. But I'm glad that I can report to you of everything we read about in the Bible about this man Gamaliel. There was one man. You're killing it, man. You're killing me. There was one of Gamaliel's followers who was not an appeaser. It's a man by the name of Saul of Tarsus. When you read about Saul of Tarsus, who was converted, he started out first as an opposer of the church and an opposer of Jesus Christ, and then he became a soul winner, and he became an apostle, but he was never an appeaser. You never had to worry about where Paul stood. Here's a question. Do people know where you stand? Will they wonder? Are you one of those churchgoers? Are you one of those Christians, those believers? Or in the year 2023, are there going to be some Christians who would say, for the glory of God, I'm going to be one who stands and is counted for? Don't be a religious pacifier. Let's stand, would you? Father, thank you for the privilege to be in this place. And Lord, I pray that our hearts have been stirred with a basic story of an individual who should have stood but did not. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Let me ask you a question or two. If you're in this place this morning, please, nobody's looking but me. If you're in this place this morning and you're not sure that you are on your way to heaven, you must decide. What are you waiting for? Now, we're not here to embarrass you. I wouldn't do that at all. But I do want to pray for you, and I do want to help you. Would you just be honest for a minute? Nobody's looking but me. I wonder if you'd say, preacher, if I died right now today, I do not know that I will go to heaven. Would you slip your hand up so I can see it and I can pray for you? Thank you. Slip it up and slip it right back down. Thank you. Is there another one? Nobody's looking. Heads bowed, please. Eyes are closed. Teenagers, nobody looking. Right now, you couldn't open the Bible. Give me a Bible reason why when you die, you'll be in heaven. Is there another one? Preacher, that's me. Pray for me. I want to pray for you. Would you let me do that? Lord, you saw these people that raised their hands, and I promised that I would pray for them. And so, Father, I'm praying right now that they would have the courage to step out and let us take the Bible and open it up and help them understand the decision to trust you as Savior. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. If you meant that and you raised your hand, in just a minute the piano is going to play. And when it does, when it strikes that first note, why don't you slip from where you're seated and let us take the Bible privately and let us help you settle that today. Christian, it's another year for you to stand up and be counted. Why would we be concerned about whether we're going to offend someone or whether it's not going to go over well when we know the truth? Father, help us, I pray, to stand for you in Jesus' name. The piano